You know, me giving you a presentation and you know, seeing what can happen and whatnot, I thought let's make it as an AMA session, that is, ask me anything. So what I'll do is I'll quickly give you my brief, I'll give you an idea of what all I've been doing and you know, things like that, and post that you can ask me any questions with regards to funding. How do you approach it, or if you want some any you know, discussion around your startup idea, or how do you want to proceed, feel free to just question me, and we'll just keep it interactive. No presentations and of course no gyan session as such. So that's the whole idea of today's talk. So quickly giving you a brief of what I've been doing and you know, how I am in a position today to talk about idea to funding per se. So basically, as Bhavani mentioned, I have my own startup. Even now, I work with my startup idea, which is into the space of neurotechnology, where we are developing a platform for neurodegenerative diseases. However, before that, I also had previously one startup, which I started in 2013. And because we could not scale it up further, we finally shut down the company in 2016-2017. And the new startup, I started in 2019. So basically, I have now experience of at least two startups in medtech space specifically. Hardware and software both is my you know, focus. So it's not like just software is what I understand, or hardware. I look at both the aspects of it, and given my educational background, I have a bachelor's degree in engineering with biomedical being my specification, master's in medical electronics, and currently I am finishing my doctorate from Indian Institute of Science. Apart from my role as an academic researcher, engineer, an entrepreneur, I also wear the hat of an investor. So there is a fund named as Your Campus Fund, which I'm representing today as. So Your Campus Fund is like started by Richa. So Richa Bajpai, she was founder of Gudera and NextGen Technologies. She has two successful exits, and this is her third venture, where this time she has entered the VC space with the mandate being of supporting student entrepreneurs. So the whole idea is we try to identify good student startups right at the start, and you know, give them a check of up to 50 lakh rupees so that they can go about it. But however, there are some lot of keywords around it, and when I say student entrepreneur, we have changed the definition a little bit. Unlike like a creator fund or dorm room fund in US, where students are the focus, here in India, student startups are still yet to go. So there are a couple of student startups, of course, who start as a student like me, but there are others who start after they graduate. So they may start a startup within 36 months of their graduation. So in for our investment portfolio, we consider either a person who is a current student or someone who has graduated in last 36 months. So the whole idea is at least one founder should be in this particular category, and they should hold at least 25% of equity in the company, which gets into a decision-making aspect of it. So that's the mandate of Campus Fund. We have successfully publicly acknowledged one investment right now, and a couple of them are under the due diligence phase. Hopefully should be public in next couple of weeks, if not a month or two. That's the whole background. So as a investor role, what I do is I look at, one, of course, we scout for student startups. Secondly, we evaluate them in multiple rounds. So the whole idea of Campus Fund is, first, someone scouts the startup. We put them in our pipeline. Then there would be, so this particular person who has scouted has a 10 to 15 minutes, you know, elevator pitch. Where we just have a basic understanding and see whether you fit into the criteria. If you fit into criteria, we move the startup into the first meet. In the first meet, there is two set of people. One is a student investor like me. Another is a student scout. So these two people together will actually evaluate the startup and see how things work, and if it makes sense to further evaluate, and is it interesting enough to be taken forward to the investment committee. If yes, then you go to the second round. In second meet, again, there will be two people. One is a student investor like me and another a student scout. And then again, the same process starts where they try to understand more details about it, because the first team and the second team must have already discussed about you. There would be some questions, some other issues. They would be trying to clarify that, look at the demonstrations, etc. And if the second team also likes your work, you are taken to the internal discussion. So as part of internal discussion, you'll be having a call with Richa herself, and then we'll be also having an internal discussion with our advisors. We have a good set of advisors, which I'm not publicly disclosing right now. And once these advisors are also completed, then and we are all satisfied, we make an investment thesis about you and allow you to present in the IC committee meeting, that is investment committee meeting. In the investment committee meeting, what happens is the student investors, right? Just like me, there are 11 to 12 more student investors from various universities like IITs, IIM, etc. So we all come together and we all listen. We are the main lead for you in the IC. You will be pitching in front of us and we will be making a decision to invest or not. So for an investment to be successful, at least 60% of this, 11 to 12 student investor have to be on board with an invest decision. And if that is true, then the next day or the within 48 hours, you are issued a term sheet. And once that term sheet is issued, there is an entire due diligence phase before the money comes into your bank account. So that's how the entire process of investment would look like, right? So that's the investor perspective of it. So now, and that's what I do overall. So as I told you, what's my role as investor, I told you what's my role as a startup founder. Now I would like you guys to ask me questions, ask me anything, and I'll try to try to answer as openly as possible. The floor is open, guys, for you.
Any question, guys? You can start interacting with Mr. Siddharth, asking your questions and queries.
Hi, Siddharth. I just joined with your presentation. Actually, I would like to know what is the limit of your investment, no? Is there any limit or you?
Yeah, so as I told Arshad, we invest up to 50 lakh rupees.
Only with an idea we can't ask for investment, right? Or do we need a prototype?
Okay. Fine. So when we are investing in you, okay, how do we know that you are capable of executing your idea? Because investor is a new person for you, right? Like the person may or may not know you in past, right? So when you just go with an idea, the biggest dilemma for any investor is the trust. Like, will you be able to execute it? Do you know what you're getting into, right? And that's the reason why any investor will tell that pitch your idea and get investment first from your friends and family, because they know you. They are people invest on you, and people are not investing specifically on idea. Idea just becomes a platform, you know, where you are actually showcasing your talent, and everything gets on to you, right? So if you are talking to a very new investor, it's highly unlikely that with an idea you may get invested. However, all said and done, if you have a past record of like successful exits, or you were part of, you know, kind of some C-level executives of, you know, MNCs or some big company, and you have a proven track record, then in that case, yes, idea may also be funded by an investor. But it's, as I told you, it's very it's highly unlikely. In fact, you can even check with Derby team when they actually look at Nidhi Prayas. Just for the government grant, they actually do a lot of discussion and try to understand you better. you may not have a fully working prototype, but at least they try to see that you have covered your ground because before you get a grant, right? So imagine if a government grant is like that, how would be a, you know, kind of hard earned money of investor for you? So in short, very highly unlikely that an idea can get invested. However, an idea can always win a business plan competition, and that money you can always use for building your startup, but not an investment purpose per se. I hope I have answered you.
Yeah, I got it. Thank you so much.
Yeah. You can ask me anything, and you don't need to restrict yourself to investments. You can ask me anything, whatever your doubt comes in. As a fellow innovator and founder, I can also answer in that aspect.
Yeah, I have another question for you. What is the terms and conditions, no, while doing this investment, this type of investment? What is your conditions?
Okay, can you be more specific on terms and conditions?
If I am coming with you in front of you with my product and I am explaining to you and you are impressed, and after that, what are the conditions you will put for as an innovator? So that's
okay. So let me you know, switch the table. Okay, you're Arshad, if I am right. So Arshad, let's say you have 25 lakh rupees which you want to invest. I am coming to you telling that Arshad, give me that 25 lakh rupees. What do you think would be the term and condition that you will put on to me for that 25 lakh rupees equity fund?
Actually, I am not aware of that.
No, don't think on the investment line. As a personal individual, you have 25 lakh rupees. You want to invest 25 lakh rupees on a startup. I come to you and pitch, Arshad, this is my idea. This is what I have done. Give me your 25 lakh rupees. So now, as a person, what are the terms and conditions that you think that you will put?
I'm firstly focusing on the when I will get the returns.
Right, one. Yeah. How long can you wait for your returns, Arshad?
That depends upon the project. If I am the investor,
you are an investor, okay? You are putting 25 lakh rupees. Okay. First thing, what is the return that you expect? You put 25 lakh rupees. What is the minimum returns that you will expect from me? Chalo, theek hai. Let's simplify the question for you. Now, if same 25 lakh rupees you put in an FD, what is the interest rate that you are going to get? Let's keep 10%. It's lesser than that, but let's put 10% for your sake. So if you keep 25 lakh rupees as your this thing, 10% per annum is your interest rate, right? So by the end of this thing, you will be getting 25 lakh rupees plus this thing, and after 1 year, and you will be having what, a lock-in period, right? So FDs, you will be having a maximum period till which you are going to invest. Correct. So let's say it is 3 years or 5 years for FD. So now, how much are you going to expect the return? For a startup, because FD is at least confirmed. So if you put 25 lakh rupees, you will, as you told, you will at least receive 10% per annum, which means your money is growing now, right? Now, same thing, you have taken a high risk. You are betting on a startup, basically gambling, right? Sort of a gambling. In fact, gamblers have better chances of succeeding. So you are actually betting on the startup. Now, what is the interest rate or return rate that you'll be expecting from that startup in how many years?
That one should be more than that you expect from the bank now.
Exactly.
Because, during startup,
exactly.
Within a year, it maybe changes everything.
Right. But so you will be putting a minimum threshold that, okay, minimum I should get certain thing in certain months, right? So in this also case, as a term and condition, I'll be putting in, okay, minimum investment period is 3 years. I should be given an exit okay, from the startup. That is, I should get my money back in, let's say, 3 years or 4 years, whatever the timeline you select, right? If you don't give me, chalo, okay, if I don't give you the exit, what will happen?
Close like that, it will be a
burden. Now, for example, you're putting in a bank, okay, bank is telling 10% per annum, you have put for 36 months. You will have to get the money back in 36 months from the bank, right? Now, let's say if bank doesn't give, what will you do? Bank is telling, I don't have money. What will you do? You may go to RBI or you may complain about the bank to, you know, some higher authorities, same thing. So the investor will complain to the board. They may tell, okay, that I should have a right to sell the shares so that I can get my money back, right? Or else you sell the shares and let me tag along with you to sell my shares as well. Correct?
If the company go down, what do?
Exactly. Now you have come up to a very good point. If company goes down, what happens? So there is something called as liquidation preference. So if the company goes down, I should at least get 1x or 2x of whatever I have given you. 1x is at least if I given you 25 lakhs, I should get my 25 lakh rupees back. Or at the most, I should have the first preference to get as much as possible, and rest becomes my loss. Okay. Or I would say my liquidation preference is 2x. That is up to 50 lakh rupees, I'll first take the exit. And later on, I will like give you. So now what would happen is, let's say if the term and condition is 2x liquidation preference, what will happen is then, and your company is getting sold for 40 lakhs. That means the entire 40 lakh from that sale goes to the investor. You will not get 1 rupee. But let's say the liquidation preference is 1x. So if, and you have, your company gets sold for, say, 25 lakhs, then you will be getting 25 goes to the investor, you will be keeping 15 lakhs for yourself. But let's say the liquidation preference is 1.5x, then 25 plus 12.5, 37.5 the investor will take, you will get 2.5 lakh rupees. So these are the next clauses, that liquidation preferences. So one is exit clause, what is my exit, liquidation preference, tag along clause, drag along. Tag along is, you are selling your shares, I'll be tagging along with you. Drag along is a clause where, you will tell that, okay, the investor is going to sell the shares, but the purchaser tells that this is not enough, I want more, then I will drag along you. So I will drag your shares into it, right? And then, of course, as I told you, liquidation preference. So these are standard terms that they look at. Apart from that, there would be clauses around valuation. How much percentage of stake will I own if I invest on the startup for 25 lakh rupees? Is it 1%? Is it 5%? Is it 10%? Is it 50%? Whatever is the amount, right? So those things are the standard terms and conditions. So see, it's very simple. Imagine it's your money. What all you will do to safeguard your money, all those things investor will do to safeguard his or her money. And we should always understand, a VC doesn't mean that all the money is his or her money. Basically, a VC is a venture capital firm where multiple individuals or multiple organizations may pool in some money together, make it as a big bucket, and that bucket is then used to give money to so many people. And the whole idea is the VC should be successful and they should get the returns. And if once they get the returns, the dividends are shared across all the limited partners / organization which were part of the whole angel or VC network, right? So terms and condition, in short, is everything that you're going to do to safeguard your investment, as easy as that. Are you able to understand the psychology behind investment? Investors are someone who is just like giving money. Whole idea for them is also they need to earn money. They are putting in money, they want returns, right? Otherwise, you will go for grants where you don't have to return but do some impact. And that is also one of the investment aspects. There is something called as impact investment, where they may not be considering return of investment as a big deal, but they would like to look at how much impact have you created in the market. So that is another type of investment, impact investment. You can always Google if you don't want, if you want to look at it. So that's always one more thing that you can look at. And you have venture capital, private equity, different types of investment. So based on the stage of your startup, you need to select which investor you are going to interact with. But technically speaking, guys, what I would recommend anyone and everyone is, please remember, seeking this kind of investment is very expensive. Okay, you should seek these investments only if, as and when necessary. If you unnecessarily raise rounds, you are gonna get into big trouble and big losses. I'll tell you why. For example, let's say you need 5 crores. There is an option where, and this 5 crore, you know that you will be able to 100% get, you can recover this 5 crore in, let's say, 18-24 months, right? You know, 100%. Then the best thing, and you have some kind of background, like your family property or something. So best way to go about that 5 crore is get a loan and repay that loan. At least loan has a fixed amount of interest rate and you are going to pay this. But if you bring in an investor, the investor will at least take anywhere between 5x to 30x is what they will expect their returns. In some cases, they will expect even 100x. So that means if you're taking 5 crores and if you're talking about 5x, you're going to give back 25 crores. Whereas in a bank, if you take 5 crores and you're going to give back in 24 months, you may just pay up maximum about 7 to 8 crores actually. Right? So if you look at where is 8 crores and where is 25 crores. So you need to be very sure when you want to raise money and how much you should raise money. Don't get into the kind of that cat race that's going on that, no, I want to raise so much and so much of investment doesn't really make sense. So that's my advice to all of you when you're looking at it. And if possible, if you have the background, please raise it from your family as much as possible, because those are easy money that you can actually get it and there will be less string attached. So be careful around that. Yeah. Any other questions?
Yeah. Hi, sir.
Hi.
I just want to know, can the valuation be increased without showing revenue and only by showing assets?
Okay. Very good question. Answer is yes and no. Valuation is very tricky business. Okay. We actually value something based on the future value in case of startups. You are not a typical business where you have assets and you have revenues and you're gonna get valuation. Startup basically is a kind of a weird or really scalable idea which can actually make sense. And how will you value something which there is no tangibility over there, right? So it's a very tricky game on how do you value it. It generally comes up and boils down to the investor and the investee on what is the mutually agreed value of your company. Valuations are done in multiple ways, right, from market, revenue multiples to so many options are there. Traditionally, it was discounted cash flows. But one of the typical one is a similar ticket size. So you can always look at your industry, look at the startups which were invested in similar stages, and you can also look at what were they valued at. So that also is one of the methods of valuation. So it's a tricky game and a very difficult to be played also. So technically, yeah, you need to be sure what are you claiming as value. It can be for multiple reasons that you are claiming that value. It could be because you are in a high growth industry and thereby you are claiming that value. It could be because you have something which is so sure that it is 100% successful. You may be claiming value for that. You may be claiming value for your IP. You may be claiming value based on your staff, right? Or your employees. So best way to look at valuation is, there's a professor called as Professor Damodaran. He has a very good lecture on valuation. You should see those. And it's a very tricky business is what I would say. So typically when we during our investment sees this thing, we look at valuation based on future projections, what have you achieved till now, what's your customer telling, and then how much do we think that market is strong, we see do you have an edge, and then we also see what is the valuation that you are expecting. Based on all these things, we arrive generally at a value. That's what we do in Campus Fund, but otherwise there are a lot of methods as well.
Thank you, sir.
Sure. Any other question?
So, to whom you provide the funding, means for product base or for software services?
Doesn't matter, business. We don't look at hardware, software and all. The whole point is the business should be good. You must have good strategies, and we should be able to, you should be able to justify that. Why do you think you will be successful? Of course, your justification is not enough. You should be able to convince the investor also that, yeah, this is something which is a really potential startup and we should go about it. And generally, any investment guys, they look at a couple of things. One is team, second is market, third is your competition, fourth is your strengths, right? Fifth is current customer and current traction that you have. So these are a couple of places where early stage investments are judged upon, or we consider these points when we look at the investment.
Sir, can you guide me please something about crowdfunding?
Okay, very good question. So in fact, I have a YouTube channel called squids.design, and we had a 1 hour discussion on crowdfunding. You can always have a look at it, where one of my friends who have successfully done crowdfunding has spoken about it in details. But in a gist, crowdfunding is basically you are asking money from your customers, right? Your people, right? If you are a B2C company, that is a business to consumer company, and let's say you have made a smartwatch, and now your design is good, you have really solved a problem, your prototype is good, you use one of these crowdfunding platforms like Indiegogo or Kickstarter or something. You put in your story, you put in your concept, you do the marketing and get pre-orders. And people will either pay for your pre-orders, and then you'll get the money, you manufacture it and deliver the pre-orders. That's one way of looking at it. Other way of looking at it is there are crowdfunding platforms, not in India, but in US specifically, where you basically trade shares. You tell that, okay, you give me this much money and I will give you this much equity. So there are crowdfunding of that method also. But but in India, if you look at it as a crowdfunding, there are a couple of platforms like, I'm not able to recollect exact names right now, but there are a couple of like Impact Guru, etc. But that is not Indian. There is an Indian version, which right now it's not coming into my head. But that platform generally looks at social impact. So, for example, what is the social impact you create, and then they have a platform for crowdfunding. India, it is still very early stage crowdfunding, and generally, if your market is looked at in India only, I would not recommend you for crowdfunding because of the efforts needed and the response that you're gonna get. It's a very difficult game for India specific market. However, it's catching up, and hopefully in the next couple of years it will catch up, but right now it's not that great in India. Another way we can call as crowdfunding is like, if you are a B2B startup, you come up with a good plan and everything, and you take pre-orders from business, those also will count as crowdfunding. And if it is B2C, getting money from your friends and family, you can talk about. But yeah, India crowdfunding is a little difficult. But yeah, if your market is global, then crowdfunding makes a lot of sense. So you have to go through it based on what you're building and for whom you are building. That's what I would say. But yeah, you can go through detailed crowdfunding video in my channel. I'll be putting this also in the channel, so you can always have a look at it over there as well.
So what is your channel name on YouTube?
It's called as squids.design. squids.design.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, sir. This is Achal.
Hi.
Yeah. So I wanted to ask, apart from the funding, like what other resources can Campus Fund provide? Like, for example, in terms of guidance or mentors?
Okay, so see, whatever you ask, we'll surely provide, because at the end, we need to also safeguard our investment, right? So let's say if you're asking that you want to get a connection to this person, you are welcome. If you want an interns from IITs, IIMs, you are welcome. You want cloud credits from Amazon or Google or someone, we can help you. You want follow-on investment, we can connect you to our friend networks. So the whole idea is everything that you would need to succeed. But one point is, you need to ask.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Also, what is the exact starting procedure to apply to Campus Funds?
Just reach out.
How do we go about it?
Nothing. One is either we will reach out to you by seeing your progress in LinkedIn or something. But it's very difficult, you know, there are so many startups, but you can always mail me or mail the general address, and then from there we can start a conversation.
Right. Okay, thank you.
Or you can always come through Jagan or anyone from Derby, and we can still go for it.
Right. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Sorry for the interruption, guys. I need to talk to our host, to all of my team members inside this meeting. Hello?
Is it for me or is it for the Derby Foundation team? Hello?
So is the grants which we receive also considered to be our revenue?
No, grants are grants, right? They help you in just building your things. But of course, we take into consideration how much grant you have received, because that tells us that, yeah, you have convincing power to get money from the government. So yeah, we agree to it, but it's not revenue as such.
Hello, sir. This is Teja.
Hi.
Sir, for a product which has a large market, is it good to license this product or start our own entity or company or startup?
Sorry. Can you come back to your question?
Sir, say the market size is huge or large for this product. Is it good to license this product? Is it good to start your own startup or something?
Okay, good question, Teja. But there is no right one answer for this. It depends on you, actually. So it depends on what is your vision with the product. Do you think you are going to take it forward? You know, do you think you have in it onto you to, you know, raise enough investments and make it profitable? So this all will depend on you, the founder, right? So if you have developed a product and you think you can license it out, that's an easy way to get money. So you just license it out, get the money, and then probably start a new startup with new idea. So that's a possibility. So answer is, there's no one answer, as I told you. It all depends on you. Sometimes if you think that you are not made up for that waiting game, because startup is all about waiting game, no? It's about the right opportunity at right time. And if you think that you are not in it to find out that window, because both has to come together, only then it's very easy to succeed. Else it's a slog, right? It's a hard work. People may tell that you start up because you are your own boss and all those things. That's okay if they want to tell that, but that's not really true that it's like that. So basically, if you think that you have in it, then you should go for a startup. If you think, no, I am good in innovating it, I'll innovate further, then it's better to license it out or sell it off or whatever it is, and concentrate on your next innovation. So yeah, that's a simple answer for it.
So thank you, sir.
Yeah. Any other questions?
Hi sir, this is Achal again. Sir, I just wanted to ask, as you've told, you have experience in robotics as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, because from what I've heard or what I've seen is, there isn't a lot of growth for robotics in India, especially, like, considering 5 or 10 years ago. So, right now, what would you, I mean, how would you rate the basically the market or the solutions available, or is the market ready to accept innovative products related to robotics through startups, basically?
Why not? If your robotic innovation is solving a real problem and is an elegant solution for that problem, people are gonna adopt it. So it's not like it's about robotics or neurotech or nanotech or anything. So it's not about the only about the maturity of the technology. It's about what is the problem that you're solving. Now there could be, now for example, if I take say computers, right? Even in early 70s, early 80s, there were computers, right? So only point is the market was slow. So people who needed it, they still used it. But then as the innovation became smaller and smaller, they thought that it can be used at home, and now today it's here, right? So it all depends on the problem that you're solving. Now, for example, earlier computers were used only for high computation, and a common man doesn't need a high computation, right? But today for everything you need that. So it depends on the need that you are trying to address. So I would not say robotics will work, will not work. Technically, I always recommend startups to look at the problem. Of course, technology is what we get clinged on, but look at the problem and see whether the technology that you're talking about is the right one to solve the problem. If there is some easier way, then people will just build that easier way and they'll just overtake you. So see the problem and then accordingly build a solution around it, irrespective of the technology that you're going to work with.
Right. So, like I was asking from a frame of mind that basically what me and my company are trying to do is we are trying to automate a process which is still going on in a very unorganized manner. So, one of our major concerns is because it was going on in an unorganized manner, it was way cheaper than what our solution will be. So, like how to study the market. Like, will the market be responsive to our product or not?
Okay, very good question. So let me ask a question in return to you, and then let's come on to a common answer. So now, let's say you are using a laptop, right? So how do you select your laptop?
So I would see what exactly I require my laptop for,
right?
Like what software do I want to run, what do I want to do with it,
right?
And then I would look for the specifications and then buy it,
right? And now Apple has come with a new M1 chip,
right?
So basically it's a laptop, so you have now Intel, Apple M1 and AMD. How will you select which one you would go for, and you know the cost also?
I'm sorry?
And you know the cost. AMD is, let's say, the cheapest. Intel is little above AMD, and M1 is really, really high.
Right, so I would go according to whichever is the cheapest solution for me.
So that's for you. Now, for some people, it may need performance, where probably M1 may be better and AMD will be not really good, or Intel may not be really good. Then there are issues of reliability. So as long as you are solving the problems that people are facing and you are able to hit the need, you are going to go for what is the best for you accordingly. Now, until recently, I was using a Windows, but then it came that, okay, I needed to do certain things and only option for me was MacBook. And though we all know that MacBook is slightly more expensive than, it's more expensive than your Windows and AMD counterparts, but where it has come to a point that you need it, no option, you are going to buy it. So that's the reason why my question was, you need to really, really dig into your customer, need to understand them very well on why they will buy your product, and you have to see all the competition that you may have. And at the same time, you should always remember, though that customer may fall into your bucket, not 100% of customer is going to buy from you, right? So you need to attract that niche where you are solving their problem, such that whatever is the issue, be it money or be it anything, they are going to buy it from you.
Right.
Same is with your classic example of Apple iPhone, right? So your iPhones generally are lower in terms of tech specification, but really high in terms of product experience. People who want to have a simple life and high performance, they go for Apple, right? They buy iPhones, even though they are at least 3x to 4x more than your Android counterparts.
Right.
So it's it all depends on how are you targeting. So your target market, your market segmentation has to be very, very clear. And only way to do is study. You need to study your market. Right. You need to understand your customer, talk to your customer. See, as engineers, it's very simple for us to build solutions. But will that solution cater to the targeted market? We don't know much, right? So that's the reason why programs like this, I'm sure you must have heard about understanding your customer in this program and all that. And I believe this is the last part of the program. So you have heard about it, telling them again and again. So I will repeat the same thing that though it is a very difficult job to get out of your comfort zone, get out of your office, go to your customer, talk to it, but at the end, if you have decided that you want to make a business out of it and you want to earn money out of it, there is no other option but go for it.
Right.
So, thereby. Alternatively, Teja had asked me a good question. You have come up with a good solution, but you don't want to do all these headache things. License it out.
Right.
So yeah, you need to really work that out based on that aspect of it. Yeah.
Right. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So any other questions? I guess we have another 15 minutes before you have your next session. So, yeah.
Sir, what are the sources of funding for new startup, excluding crowdfunding?
Okay. First is your savings. Take out each and every penny out of your pocket, because people want to know how confident are you about your idea. So that's the first place. Let's say you don't have savings. Next is family. You need to beg, borrow, steal from your family, telling that please give me money, like how you used to do for getting a chocolate or an ice cream when you were a kid, right? That's the second place. Third place is friends. You should have good friends and see whether they trust your vision and would they like to actually give some money to you. Fourth place is your colleagues, office colleagues and all. See if they want to, you know, kind of help you in this. Fifth is your bank loans. It could be a personal loan or something like that. Then, of course, you have grants. But government grants take its own time. So that's your next thing. So once you finish with your grants, you have angel investment. So angel investment is still an individual who may not be your friend and family or relative. And who may not be this thing, but they may give you some money. Next is this incubators. Many of them have their own seed fund, either through their board or through some government sources. They have seed fund for which they take equity. So that is another source of funding. Then I told you angel already. Then these days you have micro VCs like us who can fund you up to 50 lakh rupees. And then you have VCs who can fund you up to, let's say, range of 10 to 15 crores. Once you finish that, you have an option of getting into private equity, where you can, you know, take a lot of money. And the last way of raising fund is IPO. So once you have reached that place, you can actually sell it to the common public and get money from them. So that is also a source of funding. There is in between your angel and private equity, there is something called as debt funding. So where you're not taking money from the bank, but you're taking from a investor who invests on debts. And if the debts are not cleared on time, they convert that debt into equity. So that is also another way of funding. So yeah, these are more or less all the ways that you can fund your startup. And depends on which stage you are in. And all are this for all this for startups only.
So what is this government grants means?
Government grants is like, for example, Derby is partnered with Nidhi Prayas, and I believe there are a couple of more new grants that are coming. Like, I don't know whether it's official or not, but then there are a couple of DST grants that Derby is having. Similar to Derby, there are many more incubators who have other grants. And then you have something called as PRISM, P-R-I-S-M. Again, I would recommend that you go to squids.design. Dr. Lakshmi Jagannathan, who is the CEO of Derby Foundation, we had a one-on-one session with her on grants, where for an hour she has exclusively spoken about grants and funding. So that would be a kind of rich resource for you to go about it. But yeah, these are major grants that there are. That is, as I told you, Nidhi Prayas, you have Tide 2.0, you have PRISM and all those funding from DST. Then you have MSME grants, and after MSME grants, you have something called as BIRAC grant for biotechnology / biomedical startups. Yeah, so these are more or less, and even in BIRAC, you have at least 10 to 15 different types of grants and funding modes. So you have a lot of option on it. In fact, with regards to BIRAC, I may be doing another session of an hour long talking only about BIRAC and various funding strategies through BIRAC alone. Probably next month I'll be having that session. But yeah, so more or less, this is how you will be getting your funding.
Okay. So what is this?
Yeah, any other question?
Hello, sir. This is Lasya.
Hi, Lasya.
So, like, basically, my question is, like, is it beneficial if we go for a like government incubators? Like, we have many incubators in IIT Madras or else IIT Kanpur, something like that. Like, if we go there and work, is it beneficial, or else, like, if we just start our like a startup from the scratch and do it, like, which one will be or like more useful for a fresher student?
Okay, very difficult question to answer, because generally incubators also incubate a startup. That is, you must have started up, right? And there is nothing called as government incubator. Most of the incubators are Section 8 companies, be it from IIT Madras, be it Derby Foundation from Dayanand Sagar University. All of them are Section 8 companies, which are technically not for profit. Okay. Now, when you are selecting your incubator, what you should look at is probably the team that runs the incubator, the support that they have given to their current and past incubatees, right? Then the ecosystem that is there with the incubator. And then all those things is what you have to select when you are selecting your incubator. Doesn't matter if it is from IIT, IIM, IISc, or Tier A colleges or whatever it is, but all incubators are okay. But depending on your need, you can actually take which incubator would make more sense to you. Only thing that can vary is kind of mentors who are attached to the incubator, kind of support that they can give you. So you should actually see what you want, and you can get then you can get your incubator well. I am personally being very happy with Derby, because Derby has allowed me not only the fund that they have given through Nidhi Prayas, but they kind of put us in a MathWork based acceleration program, technical acceleration program, where MathWorks, that is MATLAB, they are helping us to build our product, right? So they are helping us, guiding us in building our product. So I don't know other incubators which have that program attached to it. So yeah, so basically it's not about just the incubator, it's about you. Secondly, building from scratch without an incubator, still you can do that. But always remember that it's a tough journey, and more the collaborators you have, easier your journey can be. So that's my suggestions on that. But yeah, both are possible. Yes. Have I answered your question, Lasya?
Yes, sir. Got it. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Any other questions? Because I guess we have another 5 odd minutes.
Any questions?
Yes, sir. I have one question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Mayur, go on.
Yeah. So actually, you mentioned that whenever we are going to, like, if I'm going to launch my product, okay, and it is basically related on the social cause. So you advise to focus on the target customer. But in our case, like, the target customers will be very, very different. Like, some we can implement our technology for the grassroots level people. Also, we can use this technology for the urban people as well. And there are many more applications. So how to start with? And if we think that this is a social innovation and government has to take initiative to promote this product, how to approach to the government? So that this is my question.
Okay, Mayur, let me first ask you one question. What is a customer? Yeah. Who is a customer? Not who is your customer, who is a customer?
Customer is the one who, who essentially requires the things for their polluting purpose.
No.
Okay. Or who buys the product?
Customer is a person who pays for your solution.
Yes. Right.
Right. Now, whoever pays it, if government pays it, government is a customer. If grassroots people pay, they are your customer. So please understand the distinction between customer and the user, right?
Right.
So that's the first important thing that you need to understand when you are segmenting your market. So it may happen that your customer and your user may be different. It may happen that both are same, right? So you need to understand and look at that very closely to understand that aspect of it. And be it social innovation or be it for-profit innovation or anything as such, doesn't matter. Business logic remains same. You have a product, you have to sell the product, right? Whoever the person is. Now, only thing that changes is, are you doing it for profit or are you doing it for not for profit? If it is not for profit, any profit that you get from the solution goes back to the business completely. If it is for profit, whatever you do, some part gets back into the business, rest of the part is given to the shareholders, the dividends, right? So technically speaking, be it social innovation or be it any SaaS based product or whatever it is, the basics remains the same. It doesn't change a lot. Only thing that changes mechanisms. So you need to focus on the mechanisms, that's all.
Okay, and how to convince the government basically, or how to reach to the government?
Same answer like I asked earlier.
Okay, same answer.
Is there a problem that government wants to solve?
Okay.
Right. Let's say example, you are a government, you are, let's say, the president of the country, and I am coming and pitching that clean water is a big problem. Now, if in your mind also that problem is big, then you will support me. If in your mind the problem is,
not big,
you will not support me. Simple.
Right.
So the whole point is you need to understand your customer. Is there a problem you are solving? If you are solving a problem that they have, they are going to pay you. If you are not solving that problem, you have to struggle to get it. This thing. So that's why people again and again come back to the problem.
Right. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Any other questions? Probably another one question more we can take at the most.
Hello, sir. This is Pooja. As in a previous session, you told that you were working on a product in healthcare system.
Mm-hmm.
So how long will it take to completely understand the customer needs, especially when it comes to the hospital devices or the systems? How long will it take to understand the complete problem and keep on improvising the devices? And could you please suggest on that, sir?
Okay. So Pooja, are you a student right now?
No, sir. Just graduated my engineering.
Okay.
I have this idea.
So
I really believe in this idea.
No, that's okay. So when you were graduating, did everyone get the same mark?
No.
Okay. Did everyone study for the same time?
Same time, yes.
Did everyone understand this same concept in the same way?
No.
Why?
Because everybody have their own potentials.
Exactly. So this is the whole answer for it. So it depends on your understanding. It depends on how much are you aware of it. What's your maturity level? What's your understanding of the business? What's your understanding of the problem? What's your understanding on the ecosystem, right?
Mm-hmm.
We never recommend you to keep making prototypes. Mm-hmm. It's a bad idea. And again, we all think as engineers that a functional working prototype is prototype. No. A good animated video can be a prototype. A good PowerPoint presentation can be a prototype. A good sketch can be a prototype. So use the cheapest option to go and talk back to your customer again and again and understand whether you are solving the problem. Don't invest time and money for no reason. So find the easiest way to prototype. And functional prototype is not the only prototype that you are talking about. It can be a sketch. So my prototype was a video, 3D video, that's all. And I'm using that for 6 months now to talk to people. And how much time, it depends on are you hitting the right chords and at right places. So, for example, it may so happen that you are so clear about it that every person that you talk hits to the right notes and you get a good answer from everyone. So it all depends on you, Pooja, and I can't answer specifically that it will take X number of time. It can take you 15 days, it can take 10 years. It all depends on you.
Okay, sir.
Yeah? Okay.
And for healthcare devices, would you suggest a B2B kind of business planning or the B2C kind of business plan?
Okay, so again, this is also an individual choice. So generally, in general, the perception is B2C is difficult, right? And B2B is easier. That's the general perception. But you can actually try to have hybrid models. You can always try to have some models where you can, where there's a B2B2C, that's a new model that we keep talking about, where you sell to the business and business sells to the consumer. So it all very, it all is like kind of a component which is there in your mind. How do you want to take it? But in general, B2C is tough. The supply chain and everything has to look be considered very carefully. B2B is much easier in general. But then, as I told you, it's up to you and how much energy do you have to push and get it there in the market.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks. Yeah, I guess it's 1:59 and next session starts at 2. So probably we can wind up and you can always get my contact from either Bhavani or Jagan or anyone from W Foundation and you can reach out. I'm sure that I'll be happy to help you guys. And yeah, I generally sit in W Foundation at least once or twice a week. I keep coming in. So if you guys are here, we can always catch up for a 15-minute coffee or something as well. Sure. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Siddharth. Thank you for your time.
Thanks a lot.
Bye.
Bye-bye.